Romans 5. I won't go all the way back to Romans chapter 1, but in Romans 5, verses 1 to 11. Now, some of you who are just coming in, what can I say? I'm gonna just go on, and you can just, I think it'll be useful. We'll see. All right, Romans 5, 1 to 11. In that section, Paul celebrates the benefits conferred upon the justified believer. We've been declared innocent of all charges. And as a result of that acquittal, Paul says that we have peace with God. We stand in a state of divine favor. Blessed sons and daughters of God. And we're joyfully confident that we'll enter the consummated kingdom, that perfect eternal state that is in store for us. And this hope, this joyful expectation of our participation in the glory of the consummated kingdom, that joyful expectation is sure, he says, because God has already reconciled us to him in Jesus Christ. And he makes the point that if he has already done the more difficult thing, if he has already taken us and reconciled us when we were enemies and unworthy sinners, then how much more can he be counted on to accomplish the easier thing, to save from wrath on judgment day those he's brought into such a relationship with him? Now, when we ended, we were looking at Romans chapter 5, verses 12 through 21. I want to read that again. I read it last week. Let me read it again, and then we'll chat about it. He says, because of this, just as through one man sin entered into the world and through sin death, and in this way death spread to all people because all sinned. For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not charged when there is no law. But death reigned from Adam until Moses, even over those who did not sin in the likeness of Adam's transgression, who is a type of the coming one. But it is not a matter of as the trespass, so also the gift. For if by the trespass of the one, the many died, even more did the grace of God and the gift by the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, abound to the many. And the gift is not as that which came through the one who sinned. For the judgment after one trespass resulted in condemnation, but the gift after many trespasses resulted in a pronouncement of righteousness. For if by the trespass of the one man death reigned through the one man, even more will those who receive the abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Now therefore, as through the trespass of one man condemnation came to all people, so also through the righteous deed of one man, the pronouncing righteous that leads to life came to all people. For just as through the disobedience of the one man, the many were made sinners, so also through the obedience of the one, the many will be made righteous. But the law entered in so that the trespass might increase, but where sin increased, grace superabounded, so that just as sin reigned in death, so also grace might reign through righteousness leading to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, though this section, as I said, is notoriously difficult in terms of the details, I think the basic point is clear enough. And that basic point, which I said last week, is the fact God has justified and reconciled his enemies through the death of one man, Jesus Christ, and can therefore be counted on to save them, which is what he's just said in 5:1 to 11. You see, the fact that God has justified and reconciled those who were his enemies, he's reconciled them through the death of the one man, Jesus Christ, and can be counted on to save them, isn't as strange as it may seem. That's an awful lot to put on one man. And so he says it's not as strange as it may seem. It means that just as there existed a death-producing connection between Adam and his own, which was pretty much understood Jewish theology, just as there existed a death-producing connection between Adam and his own, so there exists a life-producing connection between Christ and his own. Now, I think that's the basic point, but as you get through the details, If you've read around in the subject, you know there's an awful lot of different ideas about this. What do? I give you the way I understand it. Okay, that's all I know what to do. I'll repeat some of what I said last week, and then I have to do that because this is one of these things I'm trying to give a whole picture, and I want to rush it in and get it to you in this one period, and I don't know if I can do that. But at least I can get it out there, and you can say, okay, I see what this guy's saying, and then you can do with it what you want to. Okay, there's a great deal to unpack. I'm going to try to get it out in the one class period. I don't know. I'm going to try, but just hear me out, and then accept what you think is true and reject what you think is off base. Okay, but just try to understand what I'm saying and how I see this, and then you can gauge it from there. All right, as I said last week, I'm going to have to repeat some of what I said. Death came to Adam as God's righteous judgment on sin. God imposed on Adam the death penalty. And that involved more than mere physical death. It involved spiritual, physical, and eternal death. It is total death. I read this to you before. This is a quote from a New Testament scholar, Douglas Moo, who says, Paul frequently uses death and related words to designate a physico-spiritual entity, total death. The penalty incurred for sin. Here then, Paul may focus on physical death as the evidence, the outward manifestation of this total death, or better, he may simply have in mind this death in both its physical and spiritual aspects. Okay, there are many scholars, I won't bore you with their names, but there are many of them that recognize that spiritual death is part of this. And spiritual death, of course, is simply the term that is used for alienation and separation from God. So Adam died spiritually the day he sinned in that he was alienated from God. He had disobeyed God, who's the source of all life. So that's why this alienation in theological terminology is called spiritual death, because he's the source of life, and when you're alienated from him, you're dead in that sense. So Adam died spiritually that day in that he was alienated from God, and he was condemned to die physically in that he was excluded from the tree of life, which represents God's life-sustaining provision. As I said, Adam would have been immortal. Only God is immortal inherently. But God would have continued to give life to Adam. But when Adam sinned, he now puts him outside of his life-sustaining provision and will no longer give Adam life continually. So Adam then is condemned to die physically because he's excluded from the tree of life, which is God's life-sustaining provision. He also was condemned to die eternally. This is the second death of Revelation. He was condemned to die eternally in that barring restoration of spiritual life through forgiveness during his now temporary physical life. In other words, if Adam dies unforgiven, having rebelled against God, he will then be subject to eternal death. So this is the total death that is the judgment of sin. And God imposes that on Adam. Now this is the same thing, what I'm suggesting to you, this is the same thing that happens to us when we sin. God sentences us to total death. We die spiritually in that we're alienated from God, and we're condemned to die physically and eternally. In other words, for the unforgiven sinner, even physical death is part of the punishment. Now, think about that. For the unforgiven sinner, even physical death is part of his punishment. Now, that's not to say that the unaccountable, infants, those who have some kind of mental defect, it's not to say that the unaccountable or those who have been forgiven, that they won't die physically. Babies die. I mean, I live in this world. I know that. Infants die. And everybody, see, babies die and Christians will all die physically. Unless the Lord returns before then. Okay, so I'm not saying that those without sin, the unaccountable and the forgiven won't die. The difference, as I look at it, as I see it, is that for those without sin, the unaccountable infants, those with mental defects, and those who have been forgiven, physical death is merely a consequence of Adam's sin and not a punishment for it. It is not a punishment for having participated in Adam's sin. Okay? It's a consequence rather than a punishment. Adam's sin changed the situation of mankind. It changed mankind's situation. When Adam was excluded from the tree of life, when he was excluded from God's life-sustaining provision, mankind was excluded. Because mankind, here's Adam and Eve, they're excluded. God's no longer going to be providing life in perpetuity. So when they were excluded from God's life-sustaining provision, mankind was excluded from that, and thus mankind became mortal. Not because they were inherently immortal to begin with, only God is inherently immortal, but because God is no longer going to provide them life in perpetuity. So mankind became mortal, and that's why Scripture says that to die is to go the way of all the earth. You see, for example, Joshua 23:14, 1 Kings chapter 2, and why the Hebrew writer says in 9:27, it's appointed to men to die once. We are mortal. And that's what happened. Now, the fact we're mortal as a consequence of Adam's sin is not the same thing as being sentenced to die as punishment, condemned to die as a divine judgment for sin. That, to me, is a distinction that needs to be maintained. When we sin, our mortality ceases to be a non-punitive consequence and becomes a sentence. You see, when we sin, though we are mortal as a consequence, that consequence is not a punishment. It is not divine condemnation because we're sinners. But when we sin, that non-punitive consequence becomes a sentence. We are at that point condemned to die and no longer simply fated to die. Okay? All right. I'm going slower. You know, normally I'm... but I'm trying to go slower because this is gnarly. What I'm trying to get across. But like I say, hear it. And then do what you want to with it. But first hear it. Okay, so this is what I think is going on. The example I used was that if husband and wife murderers, if they were sentenced as punishment, they're convicted and they're sentenced to a remote island, you see, the children who were born to them on that island, they live on that island as a consequence of their parents' crime, but not as punishment for it. You see, their state of living on that island is not a judicial sentence that was imposed on them. It isn't an act of the state's condemning them. It is simply a consequence that the state had condemned their parents. And there's a difference there. You see, it's not a judicial sentence imposed on them, even though they live in the same condition as those against whom the state had imposed a sentence. So here they are living next to their parents. For their parents, it's a death sentence, okay, or a banishment sentence. But for them, they're in the same state, but their state is not a state of condemnation. It is, and you say, well, why does that care? When God's at stake, it matters. It matters whether what is happening to you is God's condemnation of you or whether it is simply a consequence of somebody else's action, you see. And I think that's important. It's one thing to die as a judgment of divine condemnation for having sinned. It's another thing to die without divine condemnation, to die simply because mankind has become mortal. Okay, I think that's an important thing to grasp. It's significant, in my view, in how I see it. Now, though Christians die, Paul says in Romans chapter 8, verse 1, that there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ. Our death, and I would say the death of the unaccountable, is not a death of condemnation. It's not a death of condemnation. It doesn't end in eternal death. It doesn't end in hell, in the second death of Revelation, but it ends in eternal life through the resurrection. And that's what Paul means when he says in 1 Corinthians 15:56, the sting of death is sin. You see, the sting of death is sin. Death as a mere consequence, rather than as a punishment, rather than as a judgment for sin, is death without the yoke of sin. And death without the yoke of sin is painless. It is a temporary passage to glory that is not to be feared, as the writer of Hebrews says in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 15, but anticipated, as Paul says in Philippians chapter 1, verse 23. Okay, so I think it's a significant distinction in my mind. And you can say, well, look, why do forgiven people, why do they still bear this consequence of Adam's sin? Why doesn't God simply keep them alive until the consummation, or transform them right now so that they're immortal until the consummation? Why doesn't he do that? And Paul doesn't tell us. Nowhere in the Bible that I know does it say. But since death as a consequence, stingless death, is actually a blessing, as Paul says in Philippians 1:23 again, it doesn't seem to me to be an issue. He doesn't tell us why he doesn't just go ahead and trim. Maybe he doesn't want us walking around living that long on this earth. Or he doesn't want to make us immortal right now prior to the resurrection. But he doesn't address it. But as I say, it doesn't seem to me to be an issue. Now, Paul says in chapter 5, in chapter 5, verse 12, that in the same way it happened to Adam, death spread to all people because all sinned. Tremendous disagreement about the significance and the meaning of that last phrase, because all sinned. In other words, the way I look at it is Paul is saying that just as Adam sinned and was therefore sentenced to death as God's judgment, all people after him likewise sinned and were sentenced to death as God's judgment. Death spread because Adam's descendants followed him in sinning and earned the same judgment. He says, just as sin entered the world and the world through sin death, in this way death spread to all people because all sinned. There is a great deal to unpack here. Okay, there's a lot to unpack here, and there's room for disagreement. Plenty, because as I said, if you read around, you'll see people that have different ideas about this. Now, with what is probably a majority of modern scholars, that's at least Douglas Moo's assessment of the state of affairs, and he's in this world, so I take he has a good feel for it. But with what is probably a majority of modern scholars, I understand the phrase where he says, death spread to all people because all sinned. I understand that phrase to refer to acts of sin that people have committed personally, and not to Adam's sin being imputed to them because he was their ancestor. Okay, that's how because all sinned, all committed acts of sin, that's how I understand that. Now, scholars are led to this conclusion. Why do a majority of modern scholars come to that conclusion? They're led to that conclusion largely because every other occurrence of that verb sin in Paul's letters and elsewhere, and especially if you look at Romans chapter 2, verse 12, and in Romans chapter 3, verse 23, where in 3:23 says, for all sinned and fall short of the glory of God, for all sinned. Well, every other use of the verb sin refers to voluntary sins that people commit themselves. So the question is, that's how Paul uses it. That's how Paul uses it in Romans. So when he says here, because all sinned, that's what Paul means. Now, you could read it differently. You could say, well, Paul, there's an implied idea that they sinned in Adam. But that requires a different, a novel usage Okay, Paul's normal usage that he uses elsewhere and in Romans is that it refers to voluntary sins that people commit. Let me give you just a couple of quotes here. I know some of you don't really care when I quote scholars, but if you're in this world, you'll know who these people are. And if not, just take it. I quote people because I like the way they say things, and rather than me saying it and stealing their words, I like to give them credit for it. Okay, so here's Cranfield, who has a commentary well known. He says, while the arguments in favor of interpretation 4, one interpretation, and against 6, which is the interpretation he thinks is correct, are thus by no means compelling, there is on the other side the important consideration that there's nothing in the context or in this verse to suggest that hamartan, sinned, is being used in an unusual sense, and that in every other occurrence of this verb in the Pauline epistles, the reference is quite clearly to actual sin. We conclude that pontes hamartan, all sinned, has the same meaning here as it has in 3:23, which is the text for all sinned and come short of the glory of God. Joseph Fitzmyer, he's a Roman Catholic scholar. I think he's dead now, but very well known, written many commentaries. This is from the Anchor Bible. He says, the verb hamartan should not be understood as have sinned collectively or have sinned in Adam, because they would be additions to Paul's text. Now, there are many people that think, yeah, they are additions, but they're proper additions. They're additions that the context says should be there. Okay, I understand. But I want you to see how I'm taking it. And when I take it this way, I'm not being odd about it. That's another reason I like to cite to you some well-known commentators, just to give you some assurance that this dude standing up here in this auditorium in the Mesa Church of Christ, well, he's not, you know, he doesn't have some bizarre idea. Doesn't mean it's right. But at least, you know, it's in a bigger stream of thinkers, all right? So he says, the verb hamartan should not be understood as have sinned collectively or have sinned in Adam, because they would be additions to Paul's text. The verb refers to personal, actual sins of individual human beings, as Pauline usage elsewhere suggests, cites Romans 2:12, 3:23, and he cites a number of other texts in Romans, as the context demands in his judgment, and as Greek fathers understood it. So here this idea, when he says all sinned, and most commentators, according to Moo, that's how most modern commentators take it. Thomas Schreiner, he's a Baptist scholar, he says the verb in his commentary, he says the verb Paul uses refers regularly to voluntary sin that people commit in their own persons, and he cites some other scholars that agree with that. It is quite improbable on linguistic grounds that all sinned means all sinned in Adam. Okay, so this is how I take it. Okay, this is how I take it. Now, I'm not an oracle, I'm not a prophet, I'm a sinful human being groping, but this is what I think Paul is saying when he says, because all sin. Now, I've just suggested to you that infants and the unaccountable, that they die physically as a mere consequence of Adam's sin and not as an act of divine condemnation for their having sinned, either corporately in Adam or personally. He says that had nothing to do with sin. They simply died as a consequence of Adam's sin, not as divine judgment or condemnation of them because they sinned. Either sinned corporately in Adam or sinned in their own conduct. Well, is Paul here? Is he contradicting that? And is Paul saying that infants do in fact die because they in some way sinned, either corporately or in Adam? Well, as you can imagine, I don't think so, unless you think I've gone crazy. Okay? No, I don't think so. You see, I agree with those who conclude that Paul is using all here. When he says, because all sinned, he's using all in the phrase, because all sinned, in the same sense he used it in Romans chapter 3, verses 9 to 20, and then Romans 3:23. In 3:23 he says, for all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And then you look what he's talking about in 9 verse 20, you see that he's speaking about acts of disobedience. So when he says all sinned and fall short of the glory of God in Romans 3:23, he's clearly speaking about acts of disobedience. So infants aren't under consideration. He's not thinking about infants. He's not talking about infants. They cannot engage in the acts that he describes. Right? When he says all of sin, you say, it says all. You say, but you look at what all means. And he's obviously there not talking about infants. So I think he's excluding infants. Fitzmyer, who, as I said, is a Roman Catholic, he acknowledges that to take all in Romans chapter 5, verse 12, to take it there to include infants, Fitzmyer says, is, quote, a precision that Paul does not envisage. Craig Keener, in his Bible background commentary, says, Jewish sources agreed, referring, speaking of Romans 3:23, Jewish sources agreed that everyone sinned, with rare exceptions, like a young child. Now here's a Cranfield again. Let me read you this. Cranfield says, it has also sometimes been argued that pontus, all, must include those who have died in infancy, and that the contention that infants participate by seminal identity in the primal sin of Adam is more intelligible than the contention that they commit actual sins. But those who die in infancy are a special and exceptional case, and Paul must surely be assumed to be thinking in terms of adults. And whether you agree with that or not, here's a very well-known, thoughtful guy. That's how I see it. So no, I don't think it's contradicted. What I was saying to you is contradicted by what Paul says here. That Paul doesn't intend to include infants within the all sinned of Romans chapter 5, verse 12, in my judgment, is confirmed by Paul's reference earlier in Romans chapter 1, 19 and 20, and Romans chapter 1, 32, Romans chapter 2, verses 1 to 3, by his references there to knowledge as a key to culpability. You see, there Paul's way, he makes clear that an awareness of God and who God is, that's why they have no excuse. They see these things and they are aware. So he makes knowledge a key to culpability, and infants aren't aware of creation. They can't see. They're not aware of creation, and they don't yet appreciate the moral requirements that God has planted in their hearts. So they lack what Paul indicates is necessary for culpability, for committing acts of sin. Okay? Which, as I said, that's how I take because all sinned. They lack that capacity. Paul is not talking about them. Now, children, you say, well, why wouldn't he talk about them? Well, children in ancient culture, unlike ours, they were not the center of attention. I mean, I know that strikes us as odd, but they were not the focal point of everything that exists. That's simply, how it was. So it's not as strange as it may seem to us that Paul doesn't address them. And Paul is writing a letter. He's not writing a systematic theology for Zondervan or somebody, where he feels I have to try to address every question that somebody might have. So that's what I think is going on. Now, those who include infants within the phrase in Romans 5:12, because all sin, they do so by claiming it. Look, okay, I know they didn't actually sin, but I think that Paul means that they sinned in Adam. In other words, the idea is that all humans are born under a death sentence. They are born under a death sentence, not simply fated to die, but born under a death sentence, born under divine condemnation, because they share in the guilt of Adam's sin. They are sinners by proxy. You see, they participated in some way in Adam's sin, and because they are sinners by proxy, they are then condemned for that sin. Okay, so they say, no, it's in Adam, and they die as divine condemnation of the sin in which they participated in Adam. So that's how they get it, so they say, they take that approach. Now, I think that's incorrect. I disagree with that for reasons in addition to the fact that the verb that he uses, as I already said in Romans 5:12, normally And everywhere else Paul uses it, it refers to voluntary acts of sin. So I disagree with it for that reason, but I have additional reasons for disagreeing with that. First, it seems odd to me that Paul would spend so much energy in the first three chapters of the book establishing that everybody was condemned because everybody committed sins, if everyone was condemned simply because they're human. I mean, that seems to me to be an awful lot of energy to spend to show their condemnation flowing from their sin. If he could have simply said, look, all humans are guilty and condemned because they descend from sinful Adam. Well, that would have been easier. So that seems to me to weigh against that. And then second, in Romans, we'll get to eventually. I know you're wondering if we will, but we will. Lord willing. In Romans chapter 7, verses 9 and 10, Paul says that at one time he was alive apart from the law, but when the commandment came, sin sprang to life and he died. Now, I think it very likely, there's disagreement about this also, okay? I know that. But I think it's very likely that Paul is referring to a time in his childhood before he was accountable for obeying the law. And as soon as the law became applicable to him, sin living in him, a predisposition to sin that I'll say something about in a minute if I can get to it. I'm looking up there. That can't be that. Oh, man. This is terrible. Okay. That sin living in him, his predisposition to sin, sprang into action, producing transgression and consequent judgment, death. Now, if that's correct, if that's a correct understanding of that text in Romans 7, then obviously he wasn't born spiritually condemned. Rather, he was born alive, and then he died when sin caused him to transgress the law that had become applicable to him. So that's another reason I'm not a fan of that view. And then third, in Ezekiel chapter 18, it makes clear that the guilt of the fathers is not charged against their children. He says, the soul that sins is the one that will die. He says, for example, in Ezekiel chapter 18, verse 20, the son will not bear the punishment of the father's iniquity, nor will the father bear the punishment for the son's iniquity. And Paul, he echoes that theme of personal accountability in Romans chapter 14, 12, where he says, so then each of us will give an account of himself to God. Each of us will give an account of himself. And see, that, in my judgment, eliminates the idea of Adam's guilt being passed on to us. And you can see other texts in this same vein in Deuteronomy 24, 16, 2 Chronicles 25, 4. Now, there are some texts that speak of God visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children. Okay, you know those texts. I think they're best seen as warnings about the seriousness of sin. You can see that in Exodus 25, Exodus 34, 7, Numbers 14, 18, Deuteronomy 5, 9. Now, sin, I think what's going on there is that sin is such a grave matter. It's such a grave matter that God will or may punish the guilty father. He may punish the guilty father by extending the harmful effects of his sin to his descendants. And though the children may suffer, they're not being punished. They are serving as instruments of God's wrath against the guilty father. Part of the father's punishment is seeing what his descendants suffer. And I think that's part of why he says it goes to the third or fourth generation. It'll go as far as one's great-grandchildren. I think that's what's behind that. Now, by the time of Ezekiel, I think this is interesting, by the time you get to Ezekiel, Israel had twisted this warning about the gravity of sin from this idea where it says here, you know, that I will visit the iniquity of the fathers on the children. Israel had twisted this warning about the gravity of sin into a denial of personal accountability. God was in fact punishing them for their sin, and yet they claim that they were merely receiving the consequences of their father's sin. That's what's behind that thing by quoting this proverb. You see, the fathers eat sour grapes, but the children's teeth are set on edge. You see, what were they saying in that? They're saying, this isn't for us. The fathers ate the sour grapes. We're simply reaping the consequences of what they did. This isn't punishment of us. This is the fruit of what they did. This is simply their consequence falling on us. You see, so they're taking, but what's God doing? He's punishing them. And so when they said that, they avoided guilt by saying, this isn't because we're guilty. It's because of the fathers. And so they were avoiding guilt, and God was in fact punishing them for his guilt. And since they're being punished, and since punishment is inflicted on the guilty, God says, you have to stop rationalizing your guilt. No more are you going to be saying this stuff about the fathers eat sour grapes and the kids' teeth are set on edge. Okay, that's what he's doing in Ezekiel there. All right, now that's kind of a footnote. Finally, if children are born guilty because of Adam's sin, it poses a dilemma. You see, in that those that die in infancy, they must be either condemned to hell or saved apart from hearing and accepting the gospel. You see, it poses a dilemma there. I say that because, as I've said, the death that was imposed on Adam because of God's judgment for his sin, that death included spiritual death and eternal death, and that is the death that spread to all men because all sinned. That's the death that spread to them. You see, so if the death of infants is God's judgment on them having sinned in Adam, it includes spiritual death and eternal death. And in fact, that's what many proponents of that say. And so they recognize the dilemma, and then they say, well, okay, yes, that's true, but you know, they don't want to say infants are then damned, because that just something not doesn't seem right about that. Okay, so then they propose, or they argue instead, that infants are, or they may be saved in some special way. Okay, that's just not revealed. That's how they approach that, but the Bible gives no hint of that kind of thing. You see, on the contrary, the Bible says, look, it stresses that salvation comes through hearing and believing. And so if infants do in fact need salvation, it seems strange, at least to me, that the manner of their deliverance is addressed nowhere in Scripture. And you can say, okay, he just didn't talk about it. All right, I can see that's a possibility. But I got to say, it seems odd to me. If infants are not guilty, on the other hand, the silence and why it's not addressed is perfectly understandable. Okay, so those are reasons, you know, why I see this because all sin, why I don't see the idea of corporate sinning and that kind of thing. Now, though we all earn our own death sentence by committing our own sin, Paul's argument is more complicated than that. It's not simply Adam sinned and so too do we sin. No, it's more complicated, okay? Paul's argument, he says that we were in some sense made sinners by Adam. You see, he says we were in some sense made sinners by Adam. He says that death reigned through Adam. Okay, so more is going on here, and this indicates rather clearly that Adam's sin is in some way a cause of the sins that followed. It is a cause of the sins that followed. In other words, all sin after Adam was in some way, shape, or form tied to Adam. All sin after Adam is in some way, shape, or form a consequence of Adam's sin. And to me, the best way to make sense of this is my opinion, the best way to make sense of how does this relate, is to realize that Adam transmitted to his posterity, that he transmitted to all of his descendants, a bentness or a proclivity to sin. That we are a fallen race. And though our guilt and condemnation comes not merely from the inclination to sin, but from our acting on the inclination to sin, that explains how our sin can be a consequence of Adam's sin and why every human being has chosen sin over God. We are bent, we are corrupted, and we receive that from Adam. Douglas Moo He puts the view I'm proposing to you. He rejects it. He is somebody who believes in the corporate sinning in Adam, but he does concede that the view I'm presenting to you has much in its favor, and he describes it this way. Death then is due immediately to the sinning of each individual, but ultimately to the sin of Adam, for it was Adam's sin that corrupted human nature and made individual sinning an inevitability. That's how he puts the idea. Here's C.E.B. Cranfield, who is a proponent of the view. He expresses it this way. According to the most probable interpretation, hamartan, sinned, refers to men's actual sinning. Death has come to all men in their turn because all men have sinned in their own persons voluntarily. But their sinning is related to Adam's transgression, not merely externally as being an imitation of it, but also internally as being a natural consequence, the fruit of the desperate moral debility and corruption which resulted from man's primal transgression, Adam's sin, and which all succeeding generations of mankind have inherited. Okay, so do you see that idea? Now, this understanding, it's held by a wide number of scholars. This idea, sometimes I think it's called the mediate something. But it's held by a good number of people. Now, there are differences on how did the predisposition to sin get transmitted. You see, that's debated. How did that happen? But however it was transmitted, you see, our sin and hence our death sentence is traceable to Adam. Okay, there are a number of different ideas about this. You have the idea that, well, it was transmitted socially. And that's the idea that when Adam tasted sin, he gave it dominance in his life. And everybody then after that is born into a sin-sick, sin-twisted society and family and is inevitably bent by that. That's really unfortunate. I live by the clock. Okay, thanks for coming.